2022 has been a great year for board games, both in crowdfunding and in the retail space. And based on BGG's website, 4,000, around 4,000, maybe a little bit more, were meant to release this year. Now, as a connoisseur of the hobby, I can confidently say that I have not played all of them. Nowhere near, in fact. A ton of great games came out this year, and sadly, I couldn't play all of them, but I have ranked a few that I have played, and we'll be talking about those games here today, in today's video. Thank you for joining me today. You're watching Everything Dice. So let's start off the list with number 10. So this game is actually a re-implement of an older game called Cash and Guns, which I've never played before. So I picked this one up because it looked fun, and I grew up reading the books from this IP. The box looks a little bit more like it's for kids or meant to be for kids. It's rated 8 and up, but I think it's fun for adults as well. My number 10, Stupefy. In Stupefy, the objective of the game is to gain points for your house, one of the four famous and legendary houses. Before collecting these points, though, there is a round of spellcasting and wand whirling. I want to redo that scene with the wand. One second. Now, the objective of the game is to gain points for your house, one of the four great houses. We've got Gryffindor, Hufflepuff, Slytherin, Ravenclaw. Before you collect these points, there is a round of spellcasting and wand whirling. Anyone hit with a spell is then knocked out or stupefied for this round and then cannot collect any points for their house. This game is great for the fans of the IP and I think just fun all around. This past Thanksgiving, we must have played like 10 games or 10 rounds of this game. It's been super fun. And I quite enjoy it. Now, the box says it plays 4 to 8 players, but I would recommend maybe playing it at either the 4 player count, or if you happen to have 8 people, the 8 player count. And the reason for this is because as you get more players, as you reach above the 4 player count, You either break off into teams if you have an even number, or if you have an odd number of players, you essentially share the role. And that isn't fun. You know, you're playing to cast spells and stupefy each other, knock people out. I don't want to share that. But yes, with that said, I feel it's best to have an even number of players for each house. Hashtag Hufflepuff. Stupefy. My number 10. All right, so my number 9 is, my number 9 deals with some energetic canines. I didn't even plan that. I love how that worked out. In this game, you're competing with your friends to show off your dog walking efficiency as you go through strolls in the park. My number 9 is Dog Park. Now, in Dog Park, this game plays 1 to 4 players, which means there's a solo mode. And it's actually quite easy to get into and very, very relaxing, making this game quite a comfy solo game as well. But in this game, the rounds are pretty straightforward. There are 4 rounds, and each round consists of 3 phases. For the first round, we have the recruiting phase. Now, in the recruiting phase, that's when all of the dog walkers essentially make a bid for the dogs that they would like to join their little group of dog walking dogs. Whatever, the walking group. What do you call a collection of dogs? Pack? Pack? All right, to join your pack of dogs. And when you're recruiting, when you're placing bids, you're actually bidding off some of your own victory points. All right, so you have to kind of gauge wisely. You don't want to become bankrupt in points because you need those to win the game. Now, once you've bet on those dogs, it sounds bad. But once you've gotten your dogs, you add them into your little group, and you then move on to what's called the second phase, the select phase. Now here is when you look at your group and you say, all right, you need to go for a walk, you need to go for a walk. You could go for a walk, but I walked you already. You can only select your dogs if you have the right resources. Do you have enough tennis balls? Do you have enough doggy treats? Do you have enough toys or sticks? You can't have enough sticks. You use these resources, I guess, thematically to bribe them, to say, hey, come on, let's go for a walk. Even though the word walk isn't enough, you need to bribe these dogs to go on a walk with you. Fair. Finally, the third phase is you go for a walk. Now, as you go on your walk, you'll be picking up different resources. All right, so you'll be picking up these resources, and there'll be some also bonuses that these dogs will have on their cards. Where it'll say, if you pick up one of these, pick up two more. Something along those lines. Now, you don't want to dawdle for too long because it's a bit of a race. The person that finishes their walk fastest essentially gets a bonus, and the person that finishes their walk last will get a penalty. So you kind of have to balance it out. How much do you really need those dog treats? There are over 160 beautifully illustrated unique cards in this game. And if you decide to get the expansions, the European expansion or European Dog expansion or Famous Dogs expansion, those also add more cards to this game. All right, so this is my number 9, Dog Park. My number 8 actually kind of pulls on my moral compass a little bit. But then I remember it's just a game. And there is a mode that can be added to this game where I'm more of a conservationist instead of a hunter. This game came out to crowdfunding a couple of years ago, and actually this is the second print run of this Kickstarter game. The original game came out in 2020, and this is actually a big box version of that game with an included expansion called Treacherous Skies. Now, my number 8 game of 2022 is Windward. In Windward, you are essentially a pirate captain of a tall ship, sailing through a very dense, gaseous planet, where the planet is just full of gas and it's dense enough for you to toss up your sails and sail on through it. You explore the planet for plunder, and you can either hunt down or research these whale-like creatures called cresters for fuel, as it's a resource that you need in order to fly your ships. You can also attack other players, stealing their plunder and sending them back home. and what I mean by this is they just like have to go back to base and restart where they were. Doing any or all of the above actions means that you gain notoriety. And these are points that you gain towards winning the game. Person with the most notoriety after a certain amount of rounds, it changes depending on how long of a game you want to play, wins the game. So in order to defend yourself, attack each other, go on a hunt or do some research, there is a market that you can visit to buy some resources and also upgrade your ships. The Treacherous Skies expansion adds another market called the Black Market, which allows you to somehow gain objectives, and it opens up the field so that you can gain more notoriety. Now, I want to quickly mention and share that you are not the only one sailing the skies. There is a creature lurking in the clouds high above you. Will the hunters become the hunted? What drew me to this game initially was the fact that I love the artwork. And it kind of reminds me of an animated film called Treasure Planet, if you've heard of it. And the second thing is this one mechanic, the movement mechanic. You can only move a certain amount of spaces depending on how far your ship can move. But if you are moving in the direction that the wind is blowing, you have unlimited spaces that you can move. And you can essentially fly from one end of the planet, wrap around it, and come back the other end. And again, this makes for some very spicy moves. This game isn't higher on my list because I've only played it a couple of times, and it can look a bit intimidating to some of the new players. So yeah, I haven't quite gotten it off the shelf as often as I would like. But with that said, that is my number 9, my number 8, Windward, the big box with the Treacherous Skies expansion. Now, my number 7 is the most recent game that I have on this list to have come out in 2022. Because it just hit retail last month. At least it did for me in here in Canada. This game is colorful, rules light, plays in under 10 minutes. And it's not the most thematic game, I'd have to say, but it's colorful and it is super fun. My number 7 is Kites. So Kites isn't a heavy game, but it is quick, it's a real-time game, and it's cooperative, which means we either win together or we lose together. And that's a lot more fun than just only having one winner. On your turn, you play a card, and then flip a sand timer corresponding to the card that you played. So as an example, if you played a card with a red symbol, you flip over the red sand timer. Right? Once you finish that, you then draw another card, and then it goes on to the next player. The objective of the game is to essentially play all of the cards in the game, both in the deck and in everyone's hands, before the sand timers run out. So this can get a bit chaotic, as some players are putting down cards. Let's say I put down a red card, I flip over the sand timer. The next person plays another red card and flips over that sand timer again. There's only 30 seconds on there and I just flipped it over. There's no way that we're gonna win because there's 5 seconds left on the sand timer. And then the next person plays another red card and we're just like, what is happening? Sand timers are flying everywhere because people are just anxious to flip them over. And it is good fun. So in Kites, there are 3 different difficulties I'd maybe classify them as. We have the normal mode, which plays with all of the cards, well, most of the cards and all of the sand timers. You have the easy mode, which removes 2 sand timers and then also pretty much cuts the deck down in half. And you have the hard mode, which introduces challenges into the game. I think if you're looking for a more thematic way to play Kites, definitely work those challenges in. There are 3 challenges, and you don't have to add all of them into the game, but they each add their own uniqueness and a little bit of spice to the game. Firstly, there's the storm card. Now, with the storm card, what happens is when you pick it up, you have to declare that a storm is coming, and on your next turn, that card is then played. When a storm happens, all of the sand timers flip over, regardless of how much time is left. The second type of challenge is the crossed wires card. Now here, you may or may not announce that you have this crossed wires card, but on your next turn, you do have to play it. And when you play it, what happens is you choose a card from your hand, pass it to the person to your left, and then you choose another card from your hand, pass it to the person to your right. And everyone else does the same. And the last challenge is the airplane card. And in this card, you announce that an airplane is coming, play it on your next turn, same as the other cards, but no one can talk once that card is played until another card is placed on top. And thematically, I guess how this plays out is, you know, when an airplane's overhead, you can't hear each other communicate. And I kind of like that. All right, so Kites is super quick, has a little bit of chaos, very easy to get into. This is going to be a one that I'm going to take to some Christmas family gatherings. My number 7, Kites. So this next game, I don't have it out. It's actually in a big box that I use to ship some of my games over because I recently moved back to Canada. And I haven't had the time to pull it back out yet. So this game and another game on my list are packed away. And what I'll do is I'll post the picture maybe like here or here whenever I talk about it. My number 6 is a Roll and Write game. It'll be the first on this list and I think the only one on this list. Now, the theme in this game also kind of pulls on my moral compass a little bit. But then I remember it's just a game. And by the time I get it going, I forget all about it. Long Shot, the dice game. It's very fun, roll and write, very interactive, and it's a game about horse racing, essentially. But very loosely in the sense. I mean, horse racing is a big factor, but the focus is more on how you can create these different combos and chains and how you can kind of alter the board game states. In the game, what you're trying to do is you're trying to make the most money by the end of the race. All right, so there'll be a track, horses are going over or running around, you roll dice, the horses move, and then everyone sees what they can do with those dice. But what I mean is, they look at the dice, look at the number, they look at the color, and based on that combination, they can write things down on their own personal player board. Now, there are different things that you can do. You can go to the concession stand, you can jersey or hat a horse, whatever that means. You can also buy a horse, which will give you some power-ups and combos and new abilities, like they always do when you buy a horse. Or you can bet on a horse. And I won't get into all of the rules because there's a bit of a nuance to it that you get once you start playing. But it's just a lot of fun. There is something very calming and cathartic about rolling dice, writing something down, ticking off a box, bubbling something in, crossing something out. And then you pair that with the tension of these horses and you're urging them, begging them to speed up as another player comes in and says, nope, and that horse moves back three spaces. It's great. I love this game. I love the interaction. I love the tension that it brings. I love the little strategy or tacticalness that you have to it that can really mess with some of the other players at the table. Words difficult. If you like dice rolling, if you like roll and writes and writing stuff down, and if you like messing with your friends, I highly recommend this game. And this is why it is my number six. My number six. Long Shot, the dice game. So now we're getting into the top five games of the year that have come out in 2022. And my number five is a very wholesome, beautifully illustrated choose your own adventure game. Drawing cards, rolling dice, and it's quite relaxing and very wholesome's the word that I would use, but it's quaint and it's just a lovely experience. I haven't quite finished the entirety of the story, but I already can't wait to go back and see what I missed in my current playthrough. The narrative is definitely something that you want to share. I just want to share it with you and what's going on so far in my playthrough. Let's say compared to Gloomhaven, Jaws of the Lion, this is definitely a lot lighter in terms of campaign, story-driven, choose-your-own-adventure. There's no real dungeon diving. Think of one of those books where you, as you read it, you make a decision, and then it says, okay, now flip to this page, and then you flip to this page and see whether or not you advance the story or you have to start back at the beginning or at the previous checkpoint. So, Spires and Hildegard is my number five. And it is the next story in Greg Favreau's lineup of Spires and games. It's about a young girl trying to be, I guess, a courier of sorts. She gets a mission. This might be one of the missions, but it's the current one I'm playing. She gets a package and is asked to deliver it. As the story progresses, you find out that this world is filled with ne'er-do-wells and miscreants of the magical variety. As you're playing, you have to decide, okay, do I go down this path? Do I go down this path? Do I speak to this person? Do I go grab breakfast? You just don't really know where it's going to lead. You pretty much pick up a card, read it, choose something, do what it says, then pick up another card. And then you repeat that process until, I guess you finish the game. It's been such a lovely experience. I'm enjoying this game a lot, and I think I'm getting a lot of mileage out of it. So I do have some small issues with the rule book in terms of clarity with some specific things, like some specific actions. And I do think that they could have used other components that help differentiate between different things. But other than that, I you get by and you just sit back and you enjoy the story. This is my number 5 of the year, Spire's End, Hildegard. Alrighty, so my number 4 is another horse racing game published by AEG. If you guessed it, you're correct. Ready, Set, Bet, my number 4. Now in Ready, Set, Bet, you're at a horse race where you are betting on horses. So the difference between this game and the previous game that I mentioned, also with horse racing, is that you're just focusing on betting. So everyone will have these betting chips. You'll have 5 betting chips. And as the race is progressing and these horses move around the board, you will be placing your bet tokens on the board. Now, everyone's doing this all at the same time. And the thing is, you can only place your bet token where someone else hasn't. So it's a bit of a race between the players as well, as we're all doing this at the same time in real time. Make sure you get your bets down where you want to get them. So the game takes place over 3 to 4 races, I believe, where the race ends once one of the horses crosses the finish line, at which point you can't place any more bets. There's also a mechanism where if a third horse ever crosses what's called the red line or the no bet line, you also can't place any more bets. So place all them bets. You have 5 tokens, whatever it takes, place them all, but smartly. You can play it with or without an app. And if you're playing without the app, then one of the players will act as the announcer. So what you'll be doing is you'll be rolling dice, moving the horses. Each horse has like a different bonus and moves a certain amount of spaces. And so you'll have to keep track of that. And if you would like to, you could pretend to be an announcer as well. If you're playing with the app, which I would recommend trying because it's a lot of fun. I like betting on the horses, and I think I'd be the only one in my gaming group to actually be the announcer. And there are some variations and some, variants to the rules where you can also bet if you're the announcer. But I think it's more fun to just have an app, pull it up, let the announcer play, do its thing. The horses race and they're visualized through the screen. They're on the screen, and there's also some music on there to create some ambiance, like you're in the 1930s at a horse race. It's great fun. This is my number 4 of 2022. Ready, Set, Bet. All right, so we're moving on to the top 3 games of 2022 that have come out in 2022. This next game combines both Marvel and dice chucking. So my game number 3 is Marvel Dice Throne. And in Marvel Dice Throne, you play as one of these 8 characters here. Each character has its own unique ability and its own kind of style or feel. So each character plays a little bit differently from the rest, which I quite enjoy. It's like a little puzzle that I'm trying to figure out as I play along. In this game, you will choose a character and you will face off against an opponent, one of these other characters here. You're trying to deplete your opponent's health all the way down to 0 before they do the same to you. The way the game works is you'll have your character, you have different abilities on your player board, and you'll have a deck of cards that you'll be drawing from and playing as well. On your turn, you are the attacker. And what you'll do is you'll look at your hand of cards, maybe play them to upgrade some of your abilities or give you some other added effects. Then you roll your dice. Take a look, see if it matches anything that you particularly like that's on your player board. If you're not a fan, you can roll them again, as many as you want. See if they match. If it's like still not what you want, you can then roll them as many as you like for a third time and see which combo you would like to attack with. Once you make your attack, your opponent then has the chance to play some cards and roll their own dice. And this will be called a defense roll. Now, depending on what they do, they will subtract from your attack roll the number that they have successfully defended, and then from the unsuccessful attempts to defend your attack roll, that is then subtracted from their health points. Then it's your opponent's turn to attack, and your turn to defend, and you keep going and repeating this process until you're dwindled down to zero health. The gameplay sounds simple enough, but trust me, there are a lot of instances that just, it gets you. There isn't a time where I don't feel like a superhero. You know, I every move I make, I feel like I am doing something. And then there are those big epic moments where you do your super and and it's great. Especially because it's undefendable damage for the most part. One thing I want to mention, on the box it says 2 to 6 players, but I would recommend maybe just playing it one-on-one, and if you happen to have more than just the two of you, maybe run a bit of a tournament and get that going. The reason for this is if you have more than two players and you kind of, there's a bit of an alternate attacking mode, it can get boring because you're just waiting for someone else to finish their attack before they come to you. And if you're playing with 6 people, that's gonna take a while. And that's my number 3, Marvel Dice Throne. All right, so this next one is it's a game that I backed a while ago, and it's got boss battling, it's got 1930s art style cartoons, it's got some flavor text that got me more involved or more engaged with the characters that I'm playing and fighting against. Wow. So while I do have some issues with the length of a game or the maybe the number of rounds, which I easily house ruled, the game takes fun artwork again from the 1930s style cartoons, and it turns it into a beat-em-up cooperative game. Think of it as like Cuphead, just more violent. If you guessed my number 2, it is Townsfolk Tussle. I'm gonna put it up here or over here. It is one of those games that is in a box. I just haven't had the time to take it out yet. So the premise of the game is someone has killed off the sheriff, and the only thing that stands in between it and invading ruffians are the townsfolk. So these ruffians essentially want to take over the town. They may have killed the sheriff. And it is up to you as one of the townsfolk to kill them. Essentially, kill them, defeat them, use their appendages as weapons to defeat other ruffians, and so on and so forth. The game is played over 4 rounds, and each round has 2 phases. The first phase is the gearing up phase, where you can buy different gear from what's called the peddler, and you essentially load up. You buy left and right hand weapons, or dual wielded weapons, helmets, chest pads, pants, because you need pants. Once you're finished gearing up, you and whoever you are playing with have to face these bosses. Now, each ruffian gets successively harder as you play along, and I think it's a genius mechanic that they've integrated where as you go on or move on to the next ruffian, there's another added challenge that you must face. And then once you get to the final ruffian, there's a whole new way to play that character or that ruffian that you haven't seen before, or you may have, but it's different from the regular gameplay. And that's another thing as well. Each ruffian has their own environment. So every time you set up a battle with a ruffian, the landscape is always different, and you can use and interact with the different items that are in the environment in various different ways. And it's amazing, this high variability. It's definitely silly and very fun. Some of the characters can be a bit menacing and a bit creepy looking, but the artwork and the language used just keeps it silly and keeps it lighthearted, which I do enjoy. Keep that in mind as you rip off Pepe the Frog's arm and use it to slap Penny Pinchetti's face in the next game. Two of my favorite things about this game are the flavor text and the gear. Both of these combined together make up for some fun and one-of-a-kind experiences, I would have to say. You kind of, even though these are just one-off battles, you make a story about what's happening in the fight. All of the townsfolk and all of the ruffians have their own backstory, and as we were playing one of the games, someone was Granny Melba, just to give you an example. And her backstory kind of alludes to a wilder life when she was younger, but now she's gotten older and she's a bit more frail. And then taking a look a few rounds later after some gear purchases, Granny's this tree climbing ninja assassin sniper that just ended up being the DPS for the entire team. It was great. Townsfolk Tussle, it's just pretty to look at, super silly, and just all around fun. And that's why it's my number two of 2022. So we're finally at number one. Now, my number one game of 2022 has also been my most anticipated game that I backed on crowdfunding. And it finally came in the last quarter of this year. And I have played over 30 hours of this game. It's another campaign story-driven game with a sci-fi setting. And it's a big one that a lot of you watching may have already know about and have come aware of. But this game, it's fantastic. Obviously, there are some minor issues that I have with it, that maybe a house rule, but it's a game that I just can't put down, and that's why it's my number one game of this year. And this game is ISS Vanguard. My number one game of 2022, ISS Vanguard. And I guess I'll just give you a brief overview of what the story is. Essentially, this game is the equivalent, I would say, of an action, adventure, sci-fi, RPG video game, if I could compare it to a video game. So what has happened is scientists find coordinates in our DNA one day, and they're like, hey, look, it goes somewhere to those stars. And people designed this spaceship, the ISS Vanguard, of technology of that age, mixed with some salvaged alien tech that they found. And then they set off. They're like, all right, let's go take a look. What's that? What is the reason for this being there? And that idea already draws me in already, as I do love a good science fiction. The way that this game works is it's broken up into two parts. There's an exploration phase, and there is a ship management phase. The planet exploration phase is where a lot of the tense, hair-pulling moments happen as you roll dice, play cards, move different crew members around the board, trying to uncover things, discover things, not die. And then the ship management is where a lot of the upkeep is. You have essentially a book, a binder, where you slot different cards in, upgrading different components of your ship, doing some research, recruiting players. And honestly, that's like the most addictive part of this game, is just managing. I've played Gloomhaven Jaws of the Lion, and those are different, fairly different mechanics, don't get me wrong. But this campaign game is the only one that's kind of given me a cinematic moment. And a lot of that investment has come from my own enjoyment of the flavor text. And if you have the personnel files, you get to explore a bit more of the characters and their backstories within the game. As you choose a recruit, you can then take a look at the recruit, see what their backstory is. And it gives you a bit of background knowledge, and you become a little bit invested and just a little bit attached to these characters. As you're going through the game, you level up these characters, try to fulfill different secret objectives that they have so that they become veterans. And yeah, you get a bit attached to these characters. And that makes it a bit all the more sad when they die. Just to give you an example without spoiling anything, we were exploring someplace, I did something dumb. Well, I didn't do something dumb. I was doing what I was supposed to be doing. The thing is, I did too much of it. And what that meant was it triggered something to happen, which then triggered another thing to happen. And I thought I could handle it, you know, with my crew. I had high confidence in it. I just didn't realize there was no time to do what I wanted to do. And that led me to make some tough decisions. It then came down to the wire where either all of my crew die or I sacrifice a few to save a few. And that's what I did. I had to save whoever I could. And as my ship flew away, my lander pulled off from the ground, I could visualize the others sacrificing themselves so that these crew members may live. That really hurt. It stuck with me. I don't think I touched the game for a couple of days after that moment, but it was amazing. It was enjoyable. And I can't stop playing this game. I can't wait to bring it back to the table. And I'm excited for the next expansion that's coming out very shortly. But yeah, that's my number one game of 2022, ISS Vanguard. All right, there is the list of my top 10 games of 2022, or games that were released in 2022. If you would, or if you could, I'd like to hear about your games that you enjoyed playing in 2022. So please write them down in the comments. And yeah. That's it. If you like the content here, the plan is to make a few more videos. So please like, subscribe. If you like pictures on board games, I'm also doing that on Instagram. So check out Everything Dice on Instagram as well. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for watching. Take care. Have a happy holidays. Thank you for watching Everything Dice.